to say I never tried. If I'm too afraid to follow, follow far, then I'll never learn to fly. Love is worth the risk. Love is worth the risk.
Pressure I can't get. emotions got the best of me.
Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? I know some people are still in the car park, but don't you want to stand with me? And let's just dedicate this time to the Lord. You know, I know this, it happens weekly, and the Bible said often, do this often. And this is one of the things we call to do. But I just want to pray that today that we don't just serve God for this, like out of a habit, but that we do it from our hearts. Amen. So Lord, as we come into this place, let everything we do, how we greet each other, how we look out for each other's needs, how we worship, how we sing to you, even the message, let it all be part of the worship unto you, Father. So Lord, this whole service, we say it's your service, and we are here for you. We're not here for our needs. We're here to worship you, our King and our Lord. And Father, would you inhabit the praises of your people, we pray right now, in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Family, let's worship together and serve the Lord.
Good morning, church. We're going to teach you a new song this morning. Come put your hands together with us.
We enter your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We join together in singing. Oh, how I love this place. Today is the day of salvation. And miraculous turnarounds. The kingdom of God is amongst us. Oh, how I love your house. I just love.
To be a part of this. Oh, what a privilege. together. Here we go. We worship you in this place this morning, Lord. There's a fount I know where blessings overflow, where living water runs free from the mercy seat. There's a joy I know deep inside my bones, never ending well, where I thirst no more. Rejoice, rejoice my soul. Come on, rejoice, rejoice my soul. Worship you, Lord. Worship you in this place this morning, God. None like you, Jesus. Oh, we worship you, we worship you. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations.
Healer there. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, I've tasted and I've seen. Of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, and your presence, Lord. Sing Holy Spirit with one voice and Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place. place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I'm tasting and I see, Lord. Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit, we say, and holy.
just while we remain in this attitude of worship, since the pre-prayer meeting, I want you to close your eyes. And if any of you have ever looked at a fire, and I think if you've got any African blood in you, yeah, we love to look at a fire. And sometimes as you've been sitting for long, maybe talking with friends, or just the fire slowly dwindles down, and what happens is sometimes those coals that are at the bottom develop a layer of ash on them, and that ash actually stops the oxygen getting in to give that fire life and let it burn warm and hot again. And if you want to rekindle that fire, you've got to sometimes shake that fire and roll it around a bit to get the ash out the way, and then you can slowly build that fire again. And I really just felt God saying today, like prophetically, there's some people here that you burnt with such a fire for God in your youth, or a few years ago, or maybe even a few months ago. And yet now when you're at church, it's lukewarm. The fire's dwindling. It's like that ash has developed over your life and it's stopping the oxygen. And one of the interesting things is if you read in Ezekiel especially and a few places, God often referred to that His fire would be sent. He's going to set a fire to consume sin. And when we start getting lukewarm, it's easy for sin to creep into our life. It's easy for those compromises to step in. And we watch the things we shouldn't watch. We go to places we shouldn't go to. We do the things we don't want to do because that fire is starting to get low in us. And I really feel that God's saying today, He wants you, if you will allow Him, He wants to shake you a bit. And then get that ash off you. And then he wants to blow on you with His love. And that's His Spirit breathe on you. And He wants to build that fire. And you know what that fire is? That fire is our love for Him. That fire is how much we adore Him. Because when we love and adore Him, sin has no place in our life. It's not about Him coming to hurt us. It's about His love in us. That fire that burns, it consumes those desires. It stands stronger than that desire to live in temptation. And so, Father, as we stand here, and if that is you, maybe just put your hands here. But, Father, would you shake us a bit today? Would you shake us and get that ash off us? That we would be able to just receive your Spirit to blow on us. And as you blow on us, Lord, let it be fueled by the love that we have for you. Build that fire in us once again, Father God, that we can serve you wholeheartedly and that the pull of the world will be nothing. That it will consume any of those evil thoughts or things that want to pull us away from you, so that we can worship you, Father God, worship you. And not just that, but a fire can be so comforting for other people, and that the fires that we have here, that we take out of this place, would change the world for you, Father God. So as we worship, I just pray, feel the Spirit blowing on you. Feel your love for Him. This is the week we remember what Jesus did when He knew He was entering Jerusalem to die, to suffer and die for each and every one of us. Think of that love and let that love build that fire again in you. That love that doesn't have a place for mediocre Christianity. That love that doesn't have a place for mediocre worship, where you just half-heartedly worship God. Let it come from a fire inside.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Consuming fire, fan into flame.
Would you fall in this place? Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Consuming fire, fan into flame. Oh, a passion for your name. Spirit of God, would you fall in this place? Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. And consuming fire, fan into flame, Lord. Oh, a passion for your name. Spirit of God, would you fall in this place? Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way with us. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, a passion for your name. Sing it out. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, Lord. Stir it up in our hearts, a passion for your name.
Stir it up.
This morning, last weekend we were in Case Comhook with Mission Outreach, and we were at a hospital, and at this hospital there was a man that I met, and he was heavily involved in drugs and alcohol. And when I said to him that the only way that he could get over this thing as if he encountered Jesus, and he looked at me with such desperation, saying, I will do anything to kick this thing. And I said, but you got to take Jesus for real. Jesus is not just another option. He's the best option. He's the only real solution to problems. And in a moment, I sat with the man on the edge of his bed, and I held his hand, and I led him to Jesus. And when we said amen, this man fell into my arms, and we prayed for the Spirit of God to just come upon him. And this man wept, and I wept. And we just had a moment with Jesus. And then we gave him a Bible for the first time, because he had never owned the Bible. And in this moment, I realized that God, only you can set the captives free. Only you can break the chains of bondage over people.
It's only by your Spirit. There's nothing I can do. I can try everything, to go to everything, do this, buy this, whatever the case is. The only solution to all my worry, my doubt, my fears, my anxiety, my stress, my doubt is Jesus. We just sang a chorus that said, consuming fire, fan into flame. Not just anything, it says, a passion for your name. Then it said that line, it says, Spirit of God, would you fall in this place? Lord, have your way. You know, it's a line we say in church so freely, it just says, Lord, have your way. Have you ever thought about it? If the Lord just decided to just have his way? What would that look like? But let's just sing this chorus once more. And if you're able to, if you're sitting or standing, it doesn't matter. Let's just open up our hands. Raise our hands, whatever you want to do. And as you sing this song, let it not just be words because it's on the walls. Let it be a cry from our hearts that says, Lord, consuming fire. Pastor Jay just said it. Just fan into flame. A fresh passion for your name. The name above all names. The name that sets the captives free. Then you're the God who heals. You're the God who restores. We sang it earlier that he's the same God. He healed back then, he heals now. So let's just sing it up with all we got. Consuming fire.
If there's one thing we learned was what Jesus prayed that night in the Garden of Gethsemane, where he, in his flesh, he didn't want to go through what he knew he had to go through. And yet he said, Lord, let your will be done. Would you have your way? And I pray that everyone here would be bold enough to do the same. Not just as a statement, but as a lifestyle. That they would say, Lord, have your way in my life. And then they would seek to walk it out every day. Not worrying about next week or the following week, but just today, living out the will of God. And then tomorrow waking up and saying, Lord, Would you have your way in my life today? We just bless you, Father. We thank you for this time. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Everyone can take their seats. And wow, it's always so special. A lot of times people say, why don't we just carry on? And I want you to know that's what we do on Saturday evenings once a month. We have times where we just dedicated everything to waiting on the Lord and soaking in His presence. On Sundays, do you know that even when we greet each other, when we have coffee together at the back, that is all part of a worship service. And I pray you never think that worship stops. Singing is only just one type of worship. Amen. Amen. If I can maybe ask the ushers to hand out the baskets. And what is an offering? It's another form of worship unto the Lord. It's something we do, and so many people miss it because it becomes a religious thing. But when you realize when we give our tithes, when we give our offerings, I believe God sees it as a worship unto Him. Amen. And while the baskets are going around, I'd love to welcome any visitors in the place. Is there anyone that's visiting? Raise your hand just a little bit for us so that we can, there you go, there's some people there. This side, yes, some people. Where else? Don't you want to keep your hand up? One of our hospitality guys would love to give you an envelope, which has just got a little bit about the church, and we would love to invite you at the end of the service into the cafe area. We've got a hospitality team that would love to meet you, give you a cup of coffee and something, and just have a chat. So keep your hand up until you get a little orange envelope. Where are you, guys? And then can Harvest give our visitors a great warm welcome? There you go. We appreciate you here. Also, I want to welcome everyone watching online. It's great to have you joining us with us. We know some people watch from far away. Some people are maybe just not well and can't be here. It's good to have you with us in the service. So thanks for today. Before I carry on, there is a small matter I need to ask. There's a lady that needs to get out in quite an emergency, and there's a car blocking. It's a white Renault Clio, DMH 492. So it's a white Clio. If you could move your car, there's someone that urgently does need to get out and you're blocking them. If you could do that. Sorry about that. There you go. Okay. So this is often referred to as Passion Week or Holy Week. And so part of that is lots of things that we like to do traditionally, I would say, at Easter time. But don't get caught in tradition. The Bible is living and active. You know, what we experienced this week, trust that God is going to do something new. You know, I love the whole concept that I think it was Pastor Don that once shared, that when the angels fly around the throne of God singing holy, 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 it's because they keep seeing a new aspect and a new image or part of God that they'd never realized before was so holy. And they say holy, holy, holy. And I pray that this week would be the same for you, that you would realize something about what Jesus did on the cross or about your life and what He wants to do in you, but that you would realize something new about God and Jesus in this week for your life, because He wants to reveal Himself and He wants you to see that, and that your response would be, wow, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God. Amen. So coming up this week, we have got baptisms next Sunday morning. Here on Easter Sunday, we're going to be doing baptisms at the end of the service. So if you haven't signed up yet, please don't you want to contact the office that we can help get you ready if that is the right thing for you. We always say that baptism is something for all believers. It's called believer's baptism. The Bible said, believe and be baptized. And if you want to know more about that, contact the office. We've got some great material that you could read through with the scriptures, etc. And if you feel that this is Easter time is when you would like to be baptized, please contact the front desk and we will contact you in the week for that. Amen. And then coming on Thursday, on the 28th, is the Passover meal. So I don't know if any of you have ever experienced one of the Passover meals, but you know, the whole week or what Jesus did was part of Passover, which made it so significant. And so if you've never been to a Passover meal, a lot of what Jesus did and a lot of what we celebrate is explained in a Passover meal. So if you haven't yet, don't you want to have a look on our website and you can book yourself a ticket? They're limited spaces, so don't miss out. But that'll be Thursday evening, and I really believe you'll be blessed by it. If you've never done one, I'd encourage you to go ahead and do that. Perfect. Then Easter service. What we've got on your chair or near you probably is one of these little cards, hey? You see them? Who's got them? All right. You'll see on the front side, it lists the Passover Supper, our Good Friday service, and then Easter Sunday. Very important, on Easter Sunday, we only have the morning service. There's no evening service. So your friends that come to the evening, remind them. But on the back of this card, we've got the little statement that says that Jesus died for, and then a little blank space. And that little blank space is, we know he died for us, but he maybe died for one of your friends or family members that haven't been to church in ages, or maybe just live a bit of a religious Christianity and have never been born again. Don't you want to take this card home with you? As a family, take more than one if you need, and pray over it. And say, Lord, who can we invite to, whether it's Good Friday or Easter Sunday service, who can come and join us? And pray a blessing on that card and give it to a good friend or family member. And who knows, maybe this Sunday God's going to start something in their life that'll change their whole eternity. And God can use you, each and every one of you. You don't have to have a whole bold message. You can just say, I'd love you to come and join me for Easter service. Wouldn't you come along? And the worst thing they can say is no. Okay, and that's not that bad. If you didn't invite them, they weren't coming anyway. At least if you invite them, you've given them that opportunity. Amen. Amen. Cool. Okay. Can I pray for the offering quickly? Dear Lord, we thank you for everything you've given us. We thank you that the very next breath that we take comes from you. The fact that tomorrow morning we know, we don't sit and worry, is the sun going to rise? We know the sun's going to rise. And we know where. And I know that that's just evidence of your faithfulness every single day, to be so faithful to us. And yet sometimes we're not faithful. But Father, thank you for providing with us. Thank you for providing for us as a church, that we're able to do more for you, that we're able to take your word and the goodness of who you are and the love that you have for people and share it with so many. And so, Father, would you bless the finances of our church, and would you give the team that oversees it wisdom on where and when it should be spent, and that all of this would be for your glory. We pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Cool. So, last week, we had our last of one of our new members. You know, the new members events happen over two mornings after the service, 2 weeks apart. Last week was the last part, and we got to share in a little bit of a lunch with the new people. And then all we want to do is just introduce and present the members that are here. So if you've completed the new members now recently, don't you want to just stand up where you are? We just want to pray for you. We've asked you. Is there no one here? Come on, guys. No new members. Oh, there's some at the back. There, be bold, guys. Come. Let's give them a hand. We know they come to the morning, and there's some in the back as well. If you're around them, don't you want to reach out to them? Okay. Father, we just thank you for these beautiful people that you've added to our body, to the beautiful people that have said, we want to serve you, we want to be members here, and we want to serve the kingdom here through this body here and harvest in PE. And Father, we pray that your hand of blessing would be on them. We pray, Father God, your protection on them. And Lord, that each and every one of these people that has become just new members, Lord, would grow in you. Our heart and your heart is to see them grow in maturity in Christ. That, Father, who they are now, in a year's time, they're going to be grown and stronger and better for you, Father. That you're going to use each and every one of them in their spheres, wherever they are, at work and in the church, to influence your kingdom. So we welcome them, Father. We pray your blessing on them, and we pray just your hand of protection over them. So we declare this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Thanks so much. Amen. Cool. There you go. Give them a hand. Thanks so much. So one of the great things we've got prepared is we've got a monologue prepared, and I want to ask Jess to make her way up so long. And I want you to just be prepared. Imagine you were living in that time of Holy Week, of the Passion Week, and think of the lives of who Jesus touched. And some of the monologues we've prepared just go to speak to what people were thinking and feeling. And you know what? It's as real today as it was then. And I pray that this will really touch you and bless you. And just let it speak to you, and let God speak to you through this prepared, what I would say is a time of worship. Amen.
I was so hungry. The only thing I wanted was a cup of water and some of my mother's stew. But I couldn't even form the words. But that man, the one I'd never seen before then, he sent my little sister to get me something to eat. That was over a year and a half ago. But when I saw him today, it all came flooding back. My father didn't want me here today. And my father's a man who is used to getting his own way. In our family shop, he rules the roost. At the synagogue, people do what he says. But when the fever struck me the year before last, it was he who sat by my bedside for 4 days, swabbing my forehead with cool, wet cloths. But by the third evening, I was so weak, I couldn't open my eyes. I couldn't speak. But my father, he sat there, mopping the sweat, whispering, "Be strong, my sweetness, be strong." But I couldn't be. There was no strength left. The sickness was too much. I was burning up from the inside out. I couldn't breathe. I couldn't see. I couldn't speak. And then I died. Funny, huh? Nobody should be able to say that. I shouldn't be able to say that I remember dying. But I do. It was a deep pit. Pressure, heat, darkness, and nothing. Then I felt somebody pick up my hand. I could feel the warmth of the other hand, but I knew my own hand was cold and lifeless. Somewhere in my dead mind, I knew I shouldn't be feeling anything, nor even thinking about feeling anything. That tiny spark in the darkness, that moment of awareness, it was the most baffling thing. Then I heard him. At first, it was like hearing somebody from the next room, a voice muffled by the distance. But then he spoke again and said, "Little girl, get up." I was annoyed for a second. I was almost 13. But that annoyance burned off as that spark of awareness blazed into a flame and then into an inferno. Then my eyes opened. And before I knew it, I was sitting up. My parents were wrapping their arms around me. My mother was praising Yahweh. And my father, he just kept repeating, "My sweetness, my sweetness," over and over again. This is when the man I'd never seen before sent my little sister to get me a meal. From this moment on, my father kept me by his side whenever possible. He even took me to hear the teacher speak on the hillside not long after. I saw the people arrive that day. Not to brag, but I think I'm one of the few true experts on what it's like to be dead. And I can tell you that some of those people were just as dead as I'd been, in every way except physically. And I saw that after they'd heard him, after he'd fed them, that same spark that I'd felt, it was in their eyes, in their words. Not an inferno yet, but the spark was there. And it made me happy. Today, Father wanted me to stay at home. He didn't think I would understand, but I think I understand better than he does. I know the man who brought me back to life is holy, perfect. But a man that goes around setting fires like that, he makes people nervous. People who have spent too many years trying to keep that flame under control, keeping it dim enough that the darkness can skirt in pretty close. Those people, they finally got their way today. They crucified him. Today, Standing by my father's side, I saw the nail sticking right through that same hand that pulled me out of that pit. My father broke down and sobbed. You'd think I would too. But I didn't weep. You want to know why? Because I know fire spreads. And even when you think it's gone out, the embers can still burst back into life. After all, I'm living proof.
Jesus, would you stir into flame once more? Would you blow this morning upon those embers once more? Would you cause us to rise up, to be the people who, beyond any shadow of doubt, no, Jesus Christ is alive and well. And you, by your Holy Spirit, are here in the midst of our meeting this morning. And we pray, would you blow, Spirit of God, on dying embers, would you blow away those ashes and let the passion for our Christ rise, even in this house today, in Jesus' name. Amen. There have been so many people gone through so many challenges in the last years, and when Mark asked me a month or so ago, would I share on this Sunday, I immediately in my flesh was thinking, oh, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to read a book on shattered dreams. And then I'm going to just, you know, somehow work out how we, as Christians, do that. And I've been absolutely deeply constrained by the Holy Spirit not to do that, but to speak to you this morning about the signs and wonders and miracles and revival that our God brings to us when we reach out to Him. And so I want to spend the morning doing that with you. Whatever we call it, you know, some people call it an awakening. Some people call it a renewal. You've heard this morning, somehow the embers get covered in ash, which are the worries of this world. It's the sin. It's the stuff that we all get involved in. And somehow we need to be awakened again. We need to be renewed again. And somewhere we need what I would call revival. And when revival comes into the church, it starts with us. It starts with you and with me. And then as we are revived, it spills over into the streets and we see the community in which we live changed and people are drawn to Christ. And that story has been told over and over and over through the years. And I want this morning to tell the story of what we've shared here at Harvest, what we've experienced, so that I might stir up in you just something of a faith to believe for what I, in all of my being, believe is going to happen, and that is that we're on the edge of the greatest revival the world has ever seen. And I've spoken it before. I've prophesied it before. I know Mark believes that the same as I do. He's prophesied it. I prophesied it well before COVID. COVID's got in the way. Doesn't matter. It's out of the way. And I may not be here to see this, but I want to tell you there is a revival coming, which we have never seen the likes of. And so I want to share just, you know, this year will be our 40th year at Harvest. And I'll share some of the stories of what we've walked through those years. They've been amazing. But But I want to quote a few things to you first, just as part of what I want to share this morning. A guy by the name of J. Edwin Orr was quoted in a book called The 10 Greatest Revivals Ever, written by Elmer Townes. And it said this, it said, "There have been instances in the history of the church when the telling and retelling of the wonderful works of God have been used to rekindle the expectations of the faithful intercessors and prepare the way for another awakening." And so when I saw that, I just thought, I'm going to just tell and retell these stories that we walked through because we were revived and we were set on fire in years gone by. And what we see here today and all the outreaches of our missions and everything that goes on out of Harvest, it comes out of an incredible revival that God brought, an awakening, a stirring up in us by the power of His Holy Spirit that set us on fire and caused us then to be obedient, to get involved in things which have changed many lives across the world, not just here in South Africa, but all over the show. And I felt commissioned by God this morning to stir up faith for a revival once more. And I know, you know, it's one of those things I've spoken about many times in the past, but in the last week, it has been burning inside of me again, and I felt like God just wanted me to, over and over and over, just stir up faith for that. We don't know exactly when it's going to happen, and as I said, maybe it may not be in my lifetime. I'm praying, God, please let it not miss me. I want to be here. But if it's not, I want to tell you it's coming. And the other day I was just working through something somewhere else, and I was reminded of Smith Wigglesworth's prophecy. Now, those of you who don't know Smith Wigglesworth, and I presume we all who lived through the 70s and 80s, you know, the charismatic renewal in those years, we will remember him far better than maybe this generation. But Smith Wigglesworth was a plumber. He couldn't even read, and when he got born again, his wife used to read the Bible to him. And he was the kind of guy who, there's a story that he once was preaching and called people for sickness up onto the stage, and some woman came with a huge intra-abdominal tumor, and he punched her in the stomach, and the thing fell out and rolled across the stage. And you think, no, my mind, I can't get my mind around that. But that's what is recorded. And many other things. He would get into a train compartment, and he would get up and preach the gospel, and everybody in the train would, you know, fall on their knees and give their lives to Jesus. Just incredible moments. He died in 1947, and before he died, he spoke about a last move of the Holy Spirit, and I want to read it to you, because we've lived through some of this, but some of it, I believe, still lies before us. He said, during the next few decades, so in other words, he's speaking about the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and we were there, and part of what happened then. He said, there will be two distinct moves of the Holy Spirit across the church in Great Britain. The first move will affect every church that is open to receive it, okay? And will be characterized by the restoration of the baptism and gifts of the Holy Spirit. When I grew up, you know, in the 50s and 60s, there was no charismatic renewal then. The church I was in, there was no even understanding when, you know, the Holy Spirit was hardly ever mentioned. And then he says, and the second move of the Holy Spirit will result in people leaving historic churches and planting new churches. And Harvest's one of those. We left mainline churches and we were part of this. And this has become a fulfillment of this prophecy in many ways. And many, many thousands, probably tens of thousands of churches across the world started out of that. And in the duration of each of these moves, he said, the people who are involved will say, this is a great revival. But the Lord says, no, neither is this the great revival, but both are steps towards it. Then he says, when the new church phase is on the wane, and I don't know if it is, but I sometimes think it is, there will be evidence in the churches of something that has not been seen before, a coming together of those with an emphasis on the Word and those with an emphasis on the Spirit. When the Word and the Spirit come together, there will be the biggest move of the Holy Spirit that the nations and indeed the world have ever seen. It will mark the beginning of a revival that will eclipse anything that has been witnessed within these shores. even the Wesleyan and Welsh revivals of former years. The outpouring of God's Spirit will flow over from the United Kingdom to mainland Europe, and from there will begin a missionary move to the ends of the earth. Now, there may be some who will say that's already happened. I don't know. I don't think it's happened. Deep in my heart, I think we've seen pockets of revival over the years, and we've experienced them here over the years. Doctrinal differences divide people. The letter of the law divides people. But when the Holy Spirit moves, it's always brought people together. I remember back in 1994, the Anglican bishop of Port Elizabeth spent an evening under the chairs on his back in this auditorium, which was then on that side, and got up and was changed forever. Broke whatever differences there were in doctrines, in practices, and in life because of denominations and stuff that gets in the way. Became a great friend of Harvest at that time. See, where there's unity, God commands a blessing. Fred and Sharon Wright wrote a book called The World's Greatest Revivals, and in that book they looked over the history of revivals, and they said there were four what they called tsunami revivals. You know, we talk about a wave. The Holy Spirit comes in waves, and they talk about a tsunami being more than just the touch or the pocket of revival that happens, but revivals that were so big that they influenced the course of history. And so they called them tsunami waves. And they said these revivals orchestrated a restoration and a rediscovery of key truths. And I want to just quickly read those to you, some of them, because they said the bride of Christ, as a result of these, can make herself ready for the marriage feast of the Lamb. So, first one was the Reformation, which may have not seemed like a revolution, but when Martin Luther, you know, when he nailed his theses to the door, it restored the truth that Jesus Christ is the only means of salvation. Until then, people were involved in works and things, but it was a huge move. And then the second one was the First Great Awakening. It was the one that was released through John Wesley, who many of you may not know, but he was the person who started the Methodist Church. And that whole understanding has had a huge, huge impact across the world, and particularly in South Africa. It restored the truth that church needs to fulfill the Great Commission. The third one was the Pentecostal revival, upon which the Pentecostal churches were built through the last century and into this century. It was released through William Seymour at Azusa Street in the United States, and it restored the truth about the baptism, infilling, indwelling, and empowering of the Holy Spirit. And that was a massive thing, and it in many ways led into the charismatic renewal, which they don't even list here. But the next one they listed, because they were part of it, was the Father Heart Revival, which took place in 1994, started in 1994, the January of 1994 in Toronto. What's been called the Toronto Blessing, but which they called, you know, the Father's Blessing. And it restored the truth that we need to experience the love of God the Father and enjoy intimacy with Him. And we're all still benefiting. All of us are still benefiting from those four amazing tsunamis. In a book that I mentioned already, The 10 Greatest Revivals Ever, Elmer Townes and Douglas Porter, they say this. They say, the real impact of a revival is realized in the ministry of a revived church and in an awakened community. And as I said, I believe once we are revived, it pours out into the streets. We have over the years heard in moments when there's a pocket of revival happening here at Harvest, people would just, they'd come through the doors and wonder why they came to church. Remember somebody once saying, you know, I was on my way down to the beach. I don't know why I came here. Got saved, and, you know, just amazing stories. And when most people pray for revival, they say in the book here, they're probably asking for a wonderful experience at church next Sunday at 9 a.m. But revival's more than a Sunday morning experience, they say. When you pray for revival, you're asking God for life-shaking experiences that will cost you plenty. Revival's agonizing. It so terrorizes you over your sin that you repent deeply. Revival's consuming. It leaves you no time for hobbies, for chores around the house, for work, for sleep. Revival wrecks your appointment calendar. It interrupts TV times. It demands your full attention and it wears you out. And we've had those moments in the past. I want to read you an account of what happened in a Baptist church in Lynchburg, Virginia. The evening prayer had been over for about an hour. Students of Liberty University and the members of the Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, were milling around the front of the sanctuary. It was late, 10:30. We've often said, I remember speaking to Tony Fitzgerald and to Dave, we've said, isn't it funny after 10 o'clock at night, how suddenly there's like a change in the atmosphere and the presence of God just comes. So they experienced that as well. It was late, 10:30 on a Wednesday night. So most of the ushers and pastors had gone home, and suddenly a lone student rose and walked to the pulpit, weeping to confess sins. The microphone and pulpit lights were off, but God was there, and the student's passionate repentance captured the attention of those who were still in the auditorium. Someone began singing. Someone else ran to play the piano softly so as not to interrupt the sacred sound of tears. And people dropped to their knees beside the altar in front pews. Shortly, another broken person approached the pulpit to confess sins. Soon there were others. After 2 hours, frantic phone calls went out to the pastor and the deacons. Revivals hit the church. Church members awakened in the middle of the night, dressed hurriedly and drove through the dark streets of Lynchburg. All came back to the church building expecting to experience God. No neckties, no Sunday morning dresses, just believers eager for a divine touch. And soon the glory of the Lord flooded the church auditorium. People stayed at the church from Wednesday night until Saturday morning. All normal activities in their life shut down. Classes were canceled. Most of those involved didn't leave for work. Some didn't eat. When drowsiness couldn't be fought off, students slept in the pews in the back of the auditorium or even under the pews, and no one wanted to leave the sanctuary because when they left the building, they were leaving an almost tangible presence of God. And they didn't want to miss anything that God was doing, like the tide that ebbs and flows. The intensity of the experience came in waves, just as we've experienced here. And there were louder times when people were publicly confessing their sins, then quiet at times of soft weeping and private prayer around the altar. And then the question, how did the revival end? Early Saturday morning, one student rose to confess his sins, but he seemed to be bragging about what he had done when he had sinned. There was no shame, no brokenness. The Holy Spirit, who knows the heart, departed the meeting. Within 1 hour, everyone knew the revival was over. They left and went home and went back to their daily activities. I don't think you can make revival happen. I think it is a sovereign move of God. That's been my impression. But I do know that we can stop it. We can bring an end to it because of our attitude and because of our pride. And because sometimes I think leaders think that they had something to do with it. The manifestations are often undignified. And people become offended. They resist what the Holy Spirit is doing. And when you ask someone who's overcome by the Lord's presence, you know, why were they roaring like a lion, for example? We heard that out of Toronto. But if you actually go in and ask the question about what happened, they will tell you they were in as God overwhelmed them, as the Holy Spirit was speaking to them. There were people who were timid. They could not stand up for anything. And they had this overwhelming vision of themselves, filled with the power of the Lion of Judah. And the Holy Spirit said to them, roar. And so they roar in the meeting. And people on the sideline look at that and say, oh, my goodness me. what a crazy church, and walk out offended. But the person who was touched by the Holy Spirit gets totally, totally revolutionized. Goes out of that. They're in 2 minutes on the carpet. Years and years and years of counseling fall away. People stand up whole, and we've seen it so many times. What a wonderful thing when the Spirit of God touches us. But don't stand on the sideline. Don't become critical. And there are hundreds, not hundreds, there are hundreds of thousands of stories of people's lives who were changed like that. And I just have felt compelled today to tell just a few of those stories of what we've experienced over the years. You know, I candidated when I was a medical student. I candidated as a lay preacher in the Methodist Church. And I was given a whole bunch of books to read about the history of the Methodist Church. But nowhere in those books did I ever read anyway. I didn't come across any of the stories of the undignified things that happened in the time of John Wesley. As I said to you earlier, John Wesley started the Methodist Church. But you think because of the need for man to be dignified, I think those things got written out of history. But if you go back to the newspaper articles, they'll tell you what happened. And in that great awakening that was led by John Wesley at that time, it was incredible what went on. Stuff that is not good for the dignity of modern man, and so it gets written away. In his diary of 1739, New Year's Day, 1739, he says about 3 a.m, as we were continuing constant in prayer, the power, this is 3 a.m, okay? The power of God came mightily upon us, insomuch that many cried out for exceeding joy, and many fell to the ground. What we would today call falling under the power of the Holy Spirit. In Newgate Prison in April, he was preaching. He said, one and another sunk to the earth. They dropped on every side as thunderstruck. One of them cried aloud. We besought God on her behalf, and he turned her heaviness into joy. How often haven't we seen people come up front sobbing and sobbing in the presence of God? They fall under the power of the Holy Spirit, and then next thing they're laughing. And Christians are happy if people cry, but if they laugh, it's offensive. The joy of the Lord is our strength. And so there were big cries there, right? There's a big reaction. Cries of fraud, trickery, or demon possession. We know when the Holy Spirit moves, every spirit moves. As John Arnott says, is he coming or is he going? That's all we need to know. And in the presence of God, he's going for sure. A doctor described one woman with strong cries until great drops of sweat ran down her face and all her bones shook when both her soul and body were healed in a moment. And the doctor acknowledged it was the finger of God on that lady. In 1740, Wesley was overcome with laughter. That you don't hear about much because it's also one of those things difficult to understand. He was uncertain what to make of it. In his diary of May the 9th, it reads, concerning the laughter he had experienced some 10 or 11 years before, he said, part of a Sunday, my brother and I, that's Charles Wesley, who wrote all the, you know, he wrote so many hymns. Part of Sunday, my brother and I, we then used to walk in the meadows singing psalms. But one day, just as we were beginning to sing, he burst out in a loud laughter. I asked him if he were distracted. And I began to be very angry, and presently after to laugh as loud as he. Nor could we possibly refrain, though we were ready to tear ourselves in pieces, but we were forced to go home without singing another line. When I was still in the medical practice back in the early 90s, Pastor Ivan had gone away, and Pastor Keith was here. Jill's husband Keith was leading the meeting, and I was sitting the equivalent of somewhere down there. It was a Sunday evening. And I thought God had told me a joke. And I started giggling. And it was probably the first time I was ever overwhelmed by the presence of God. But I laughed and laughed until I nearly fell off the chair. And of course, I then had talk about them being distracted. I had distracted the entire congregation. And I'm the GP in the house. I'm the respected doctor. And I'm screaming with laughter. I said to them, I thought I better go and just tell the congregation, because I was an elder, and I thought I better just explain what's going on. So I come to the front of the congregation here, and I'm up on the stage, and I get to just at the stairs of the stage, I collapse there, and I'm beating the stage, screaming with laughter. And eventually I said to Pastor Keith, can I please just explain to the people what happened? And I said, the Lord told me a joke, and I don't remember anything else. I couldn't remember the joke, couldn't remember. I was so embarrassed. But something deep, deep, deep happened inside of me. Now, I don't understand all of this stuff. Gave the mic back and went and sat down, fairly ashamed in my seat, and tried to behave myself. We had moments when we were drunk, so drunk in the Holy Spirit. I remember one day, again, Pastor Ivan wasn't here, and Fani van Rooyen and oh my goodness me, and Willie Downing and I, we're standing up in the front, and we're trying to hold each other up to run the service, and we couldn't. I mean, we first one had to be supported, then the other. We were so drunk in the Spirit. I can't explain those things, but His presence was so powerful there. In June 1994, I was still in the medical practice. All of the pastors left to Singapore to go and learn about cell churches. And Ian Vermeerten and I were left here, and Lynn Foster, Ivan's wife. It was the year in which January 1994, the Toronto blessing or the Toronto revival broke out. And in June of that year, the Spirit of God came upon this church, and we were overwhelmed. We had meetings every night of the week, and we filled the place. That was when the Anglican bishop ended up under the chairs. It was during those times, and it's been a long journey of learning to host the presence of God for me, making room, not getting in the way of what He wants to do. We had moments. I can't explain all of it, but we had moments. One night, one of the ladies went and fetched an old paint bucket from the back of the, in the back. There was no paint in it, fortunately. But she brought it, and it was empty. She came to the front. She said, "The Lord told me to go and get a bucket and pour it over you, Pastor John." I said, "Okay, I don't know. I don't get it." But so I was down on the bottom there, and she took the bucket and she tipped it over me like that. And I collapsed in a heap on the floor, and I screamed with laughter. And I laughed and I laughed. And everybody, now I'm leading the meeting. You must know it's very undignified. And everybody who walked through the puddle fell down and began laughing. How do you explain that? I don't understand all of it, but that's what happened. One night I was with Tony Fitzgerald, and he was leading the meeting. We were having a wonderful time. Tony had the most incredible words of knowledge. And I mean, if you've ever heard him operate in words of knowledge, it was phenomenal. And I'm sitting there, people touched all over the show. Next thing, the whole of the front of the auditorium, it's just packed with people on the floor, weeping, crying, laughing, being touched by God, times of deep ministry happening, and the floor's full in the Lord. And I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, well, we can do this thing. We can make this happen. We just need a good worship team, and you get up and just, And God said to me, I remember the Holy Spirit saying to me, "You're getting religious because you think you can make it happen through whatever." And I had years before, when Dave Cape was here for an outreach at one point, at the end of the meeting, and I said, it's like the 10 o'clock time, but it was through the whole meeting, God said to me, "I want you to do head over heels." Oh, God, please, no. I'm a doctor. I mean, these are my patients. I'm an elder in the church. And so, and I was reasoning with God through all of this stuff, and then at the end of the meeting, I was on my way out through that back door, which was the back door at that stage, and I'm walking down the aisle like that, and God said to me, "You can't go home until you've done your head over heels." So I came back, I said, "Dave, I'm sorry, man, but can I just do some head over heels? I just want to be..." Most of the people were gone by that stage. I got down on that side, and I went head over heels and smacked into the chairs on that side of the auditorium. Nothing happened. I got up and I went home. But something broke inside of me in those days through obedience, doing that which God told me to do that I had no understanding of. And so this night with Tony, when he's up front and I'm sitting and God says to me, "I want you to do head over heels again." I think, God, no, please. I said, I'm now the senior pastor of Harvest. I said, please, Lord, not. And then I started negotiating. There was an aisle that way at that stage. And I said, it was empty and dark. And I said, Lord, I'll go and do my head over heels there. And as I said that, I'm now negotiating. The whole front row in the auditorium, they all got up at the same time and they went and sat down. And now I'm left with a pathway right across the front of the auditorium, in front of everybody. And I got down on my head and knees, and I went head over, got to about there. And the power of God hit me so powerfully, I couldn't get up. And it was from after that that I began to just have the incredible privilege of hosting God's presence. And we had a meeting sometime later. It was a Church of the Nations meeting down at Jeffreys Bay. And we were all there, Dave Cape and Tony Fitzgerald and all of our folk from here. And I was ministering one evening, and there was just such a powerful anointing, and people were up front just, and I was praying for them. In fact, at one stage, the power was so strong, I was running up and down, just touching people in their hands, and there were people flying all over the show and stuff just happening, and I don't understand all of it. I must be honest, after all these years, I do not understand it all. And then they said to me, you need to pray for the other guys, just for an impartation. And I did. I remember praying for Louis Ellison, for various people, but nothing seemed to happen. And I went across to Tony. Tony was sitting on the stage in the Victory Church in Jeffreys Bay. He was just sitting there. And I said, Tony, can I pray for you? And he said, yeah, sure. And put out his hand. And as I touched him, I remember is, it was, I went over his head like that, off the ground, over his head, and landed on my back on the stage. And I thought, God, I am undone. And I went back that evening. We were staying in a bed and breakfast in Jeffreys Bay, and I said to him, said to Dave and Tony, and I've always held myself accountable to those two men. I said to them, guys, you've got to help me, please. I'm either demon-possessed, or that was the Spirit of God. But John Scholes was not there in that, because I was in no way on earth. You can conjure up what happened. I've stood on my head at times. I don't always remember doing it. When God said, the first time I was up in the Church of the Nations meeting, we were up in Johannesburg in Robin Hills, New Creation Church. God just said to me, as I was preparing for the service, he said to me, just, you share the word, but he said, you just stand on your head, I'll do the rest. God, no, please. And I remember standing on my head, and the power of God hit the meeting like you cannot believe. It's happened on other occasions. I was asked to speak at Immerse, which is a group of Baptist churches that have experienced revival. And they were meeting down in Cape Town in Sun Valley and at King's Church there. And they asked me to come and share some of my experiences. And so I went. And I got to the end of my sessions over 2 days. Dwayne was with me, and Jean Pinard, and I felt like, just as we got to the end, there was such a resistance, and I didn't know what to do. And God said to me, "Just go and stand on your head on the stage." Oh no, Lord, not again. And I said to Jean and to Dwayne, "Listen, my neck's starting to give in on this. Can you guys just keep my neck off the?" And they battled. The anointing of God was so, they battled to keep me up. I could hear them swaying, but I was upside down this way looking backwards. I didn't see what happens, but I heard chairs crash all around as the Holy Spirit just overwhelmed people, and they came falling down. It's what Wesley described. I don't understand it, but we can't ride it out. There were moments, I remember up in Johannesburg, the time when the gold dust appeared. If you've never heard about the gold dust, I'll tell you what happened. Busy praying and praising God, we're in worship. And I looked down and my hand, my palms are covered in gold dust. And Herbie van der Merwe, who's going to be with the Lord now, he was such a precious, precious friend, and he was administrator here at Harvest at the time. He was a dentist, and I said to him, Herbie, please just have a look. You've worked as a dentist with gold. What's this here in my hands? And he goes like this through my finger, and he says, he put it on the back of his Bible, and he said, it's gold. Tony Fitzgerald had it tested at one point. It was 24 carat. I don't understand it. There were two men here at Harvest who got gold teeth. If you've never heard about the gold teeth, Tony Upman was one of them. When Tony went to be with the Lord not long ago, his son Mark said to me, we did not know what to do with the gold tooth. But it went with him into the into the crematorium. So we didn't know. It's just so holy. Two men had them. They went to their dentists to say, did you do this? And the dentist said, no, but whoever did a jolly good job of it. There were feathers that fell in meetings. I didn't ever see those. I didn't see the jewels. But we did have Bob Dooley here. He came out with Tony one year. And he used to have oil that came out of his fingers when the anointing fell. And he prayed for me one night in my shirt. It smelled so glorious. I've never smelt anointing oil so glorious. And I hung that shirt, and it hung in my cupboard for 6 months, and that incredible aroma was there all that time. But man doesn't like having his dignity assailed. I realize I've gone on, but I want to just end with this. When David brought the Ark of the Covenant back to the city of David, he danced before the Lord. He was so, so happy that finally the presence of God had come back to the house. David then made a tabernacle for him in which there was no separation. It was a New Testament tabernacle in many ways because there was no separation between the ark and the people. But he danced with such abandonment in his undergarments. His wife was offended and she said, my goodness, didn't you distinguish yourself before the people today? Offended as she saw him with abandonment declare his love and his joy in God. And 2 Samuel chapter 6 verse 21 says, David retorted to Michal, I was dancing before the Lord, and I am willing to look even more foolish than this, even to be humiliated in my own eyes. And sadly for Michal, his wife, who was Saul's daughter, there was a consequence. She, it says in 2 Samuel 6:21, so Michal, the daughter of Saul, remained childless throughout her entire life. And I think there's a picture there. I think when we begin to say something is not of God, when we stand on the sidelines and we criticize, when we get offended by something that God does, I think we bring upon ourselves a spiritual dryness, a spiritual barrenness that we may live with for the rest of our lives. Nobody really understood it when the day of Pentecost came. Acts 2:12, they said they stood there amazed and perplexed. What can this mean, they asked each other. Oh, they're drunk, some said. And then Peter gets up and explains it all. We pray for signs and wonders and miracles, and then God does something. And we wonder what it's all about. What is the gold about? What are the gold teeth about? We wonder about that. Well, you prayed for a wonder. If you don't wonder what it is, it's not a wonder. Ephesians 5 verse 18, don't be drunk with wine because that'll ruin your life. Instead, let the Holy Spirit fill and control you. The message says it this way. Ephesians 5:18, don't drink too much wine. That cheapens your life. Drink the Spirit of God. Huge drafts of Him. I'm going to ask the worship team just to quietly minister in the background. I want to release you if you need to go. But I know that there are some here today who just want that fresh, that freshness, that refreshing. You know, we always spoke about how we say, how Peter said to the folk, he said, repent, and times of refreshing will come from the presence of the Lord. The other thing that happens is that God said, if you will draw near to me, I will draw near to you. There's something that happens as we come to God and have an expectation. And I don't know what He's going to do. I said to you, I cannot conjure up anything. We cannot make anything happen. Last year in Asbury, it's in the United States, you might have read, they had a presence of God came into the chapel with the students. It's a very conservative place. They weren't rolling around. People just sat transfixed in their chairs for hours and hours as the presence of God ministered to them. And I don't know what God wants to do in your life today. But Father, I pray that you by your Holy Spirit would minister life to those who need it, who need that fresh awakening, who need that fresh touch of your Holy Spirit. And so I simply pray, come Holy Spirit and do that which only you can do. As you awaken afresh in us, as you revive us, as you renew us in your power, would you blow off the ashes, as JJ shared in that picture that he had, would you blow off the ashes and cause the embers to flare up again? And then let's pack wood on that fire. Let the passion that we have for Jesus may grow and grow and grow. So if you want to this morning just to perhaps draw nearer to the Lord, I'm going to ask you if you'd hold your hands out in front of you. If you come up front, it's just a place that I can contact you. And some may want to just stay in your seats, and some may need to go home. Whatever it is you need this morning, may God meet you where you are, and may He blow in the power of His Holy Spirit on every aspect of your life. Amen. Thanks, Dwayne.
Of heaven, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. A holy anointing, the power of your presence, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. We need a fresh fragrance of heaven, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. A holy anointing, the power of your presence, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. We need a fresh wind, fragrance of heaven, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. A holy anointing, the power of your presence, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. Fragrance of heaven, pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. A holy anointing, prophesy and see. We can hear the wind blowing, blowing, blowing. Move upon our praise. Sons and daughters sing. We can hear the wind blowing, blowing, blowing. Let all the redeemed prophesy. Fragrance of heaven.